So in this section, we're going to discuss the notion of boundary conditions, okay? And so it turns out that even if you have a PDE, right, and even if you have an initial condition for your PDE, for kind of the problems that we're considering, you know, to start, like heat equation on a one-dimensional rod, just the PDE and just the initial condition aren't enough to uniquely determine a solution, okay? And the missing piece is essentially what's happening at the boundaries, right? And so that's what this section is all about, describing kind of at a very, very initial kind of first step, what it means to talk about boundary conditions for kind of PDEs. And so here we're going to talk about, you might say like three, main kinds of boundary conditions that will appear, especially in kind of these first few sections. First is, well, let's prescribe a boundary, or let's prescribe a temperature to the rod at each endpoint. The book likes to describe this as, right, heat the rod or get the rod to some temperature that you'd like it at, and then put both ends of the rod in, say, water baths that are kept at set temperatures. And so at the ends of the rod, right, you're going to have some set temperature, and that's going to come from this water bath or whatever. And then the question is, right, you have a set temperature at the ends, you have an initial temperature in the interior, right? How does temperature change? Another kind of boundary condition is what we'll call kind of these insulated boundaries, right? Where you're not specifying kind of the temperature at the boundaries, but instead you're specifying, how much heat can flow in or out at the boundaries. And so we call them insulated in part because, if we'll call this perfectly insulated, right? If no heat is allowed to flow in or out, then those turn out to be particularly nice boundary conditions, and they can be described in kind of a very satisfactory way. And then kind of as a mix of these two pieces, what we're going to do is also look at what we'll call Newton's law of cooling and just look at that, what that might look like for kind of this 1D rod, right? Where the kind of change in temperature or the flux at either endpoint of the rod is dictated by Newton's law of cooling. Okay. So when we say prescribe temperature, the boundaries, we have a sense of what that might mean physically. What does that mean mathematically? Well, all we're saying is, right, mathematically, here's our solution to the heat equation, right? And so I'll say this, this solves, and I'll write it in this form, okay, d squared u dx squared, right? And then maybe the temperature at time zero has some distribution f. Right, so U is a solution to this PDE with this initial condition. And so what we're saying is, right, at x equals zero, right, pick a time and we have some prescribed temperature at that time. Okay. Let's see. And so of course, special case might be, well, we could say, well, what if, let's say as a special case, what if U at T, right? So the temperature at the left endpoint for any time, right? Maybe that's going to be zero, okay? And that's a perfectly good boundary condition, right? We're specifying what's happening to this kind of solution at that point. Of course, right, this is just for one end of the rod. If you want to specify temperature for the right end of the rod, right, that occurs at x coordinate x equals L. And so that might look like, So we would write this as something like temperature X equals L for a given time T. This is some prescribed temperature U sub R of T, where I'm using these subscripts to be, right? This is some function that we're given describing the temperature at the left endpoint. And then this is some prescribed temperature, some function that we're given defined for the right endpoint. Okay. And so maybe here's a good place to state, right? So why would we expect to have or to need, right, these boundary conditions? Well, if we look at the PDE, right? So we're looking for functions U that satisfy all of this. And so in here, right, we have one time derivative. Okay. So if you think back to ODEs, right, however many kind of derivatives or orders of derivatives appear, you need that many pieces of information to uniquely determine a solution. So here, right, we have one time derivative. So we would expect to have one piece of information related to time to kind of get us going to uniquely kind of solve this problem. And so that unique piece or that piece of time information, that's exactly what this initial condition is, okay? So one time derivative means we need one piece of time information. Likewise, we have two spatial derivatives, right? And so because of that, right, we might expect to need two pieces of spatial information to uniquely determine kind of the behavior of our function U just in space, okay? So hopefully that's a little more intuition as to why, you know, we'd even want to consider boundary conditions. Okay, so another kind of boundary condition, kind of as I was getting at, are these insulated boundaries, right? Where instead of specifying the value of the function or the temperature at either endpoint, instead what we're doing is specifying kind of the flow of energy or the flux at the endpoints, okay? So mathematically, what does that mean? Right, well, we're just prescribing a given flux, the boundaries. And so here's a typo. Given flux at the boundaries. And so what does that mean? Well, flux, we were calling phi, okay? So what is a flux at x equals zero, which is the left endpoint of our rod? That's gonna be some given function, phi sub L, right? Or flux at the left endpoint. Some function of time, okay? And so we can also rewrite this, right, using kind of Fourier's law, right? Instead of working with flux, we can describe this in terms of the temperature, right? This is Fourier's law. And so, right, well, what does it mean to describe the flux? It means to give some condition on the first spatial derivative of your solution at that endpoint, right? And so of course, because we're defining, right, something for flux here, we also have this minus K zero, but this is just gonna be some constant. So in practice, we don't worry about it. So in general, this condition, we would just write as the derivative at the left endpoint, X equals zero. This is just some function, some specified function of time, okay? And of course, if we wanted to specify anything at the right endpoint, that condition might look like udx at x equals L. This is gonna be some prescribed function for the right endpoint, right? So this would be right endpoint. Okay. Okay, and so as a special case, right, what we'll do is we'll say, well, maybe a rod is perfectly insulated, right, meaning that we're not allowing any sort of flux or any sort of energy flow or, right, yeah, we're not allowing any flux at either of the endpoints. Okay. And so mathematically, we interpret that as saying, well, whatever the specified function is, just going to be a constant. It's just going to be zero. Okay. And so, of course, going back up here, right, if this thing right here is zero, this is just a constant, say, divide through. And so we do, in fact, just end up with this thing right here has to be zero. Okay. And so generally, when we prescribe conditions on the flux, these are the ones that we'll be working with. Though, of course, we can mix and match, like we'll see in a second. But the point here is that, right, again, we need two pieces of spatial information. So another possibility for that piece of information is the derivative at the left and or right endpoint of the function that we're interested in. Okay. And so then the final example is going to be, as I mentioned, a mix and match of the two that we're calling Newton's law of cooling, but it's just another possible boundary condition you can have. So what is Newton's law of cooling? Well, right, it tells you that the kind of flow or the change in energy or change in temperature is proportional to, right, the difference between the temperature of where you're at and the temperature of kind of the exterior or the ambience or what have you. Okay, so mathematically, right, it looks like this. So, right, the flux that we care about, or right, we're specifying the flux, we're specifying the kind of the flow of energy, right, and how temperature is changing. So the flux is going to be proportional to some given, or the temperature of where we're at, and the difference between that and this external temperature, okay? And so, of course, if we use Fourier's law, right, we can rewrite flux in this way. And so then in particular, right, this boundary condition now involves both the derivative and the the temperature, okay? And so maybe another way to write this would be, let's see. So if we move, right, this term to the other side, we're going to get H, which is in this case just some constant, U of 0, comma T minus K0 of du dx at 0, comma T. All of this is equal to H times U sub E of T. And so the point in writing it this way is, what we're doing is we're highlighting that we're taking a linear combination of, right, a temperature and kind of a derivative and using that to specify our boundary condition, okay? And so here, right, the linear combination is the value of U, right, times some constant plus the value of the derivative, plus some constant. All of that is going to be equal to some prescribed function, okay? It's just another flavor of boundary condition that can appear, okay? And so one other note is that, you know, the choice of sign convention here. So as written, and kind of the book describes it a little more and kind of the physical reasoning behind this. But here we're treating H as some positive constant, okay? And then these signs, you can figure them out just by looking at, right, where is energy flowing? Is the temperature kind of at the end of the rod higher or lower than the ambient temperature? And then, you know, is the flux going to be into the rod or out of the rod? You can figure it out, you can play around with it. But the point I want to make here is that, right, all we're doing is specifying something about the value of the function and its derivatives at the endpoint. And that's, this whole thing is going to be one of the two pieces of information we need, coming from the fact that we have a second derivative in the heat equation. Okay. And yes.